This is Kyle Madsen with your top stories on Sports 1140. The Kings didn't play last night, but they did get a big win in Minnesota because the Timberwolves knocked off the Clippers 130-120 to move Sacramento into the number 8 seed in the West by a half game. That's right, if the playoffs started today, the Sacramento Kings would be in. Russell Westbrook set an NBA record with his 10th consecutive triple-double in Oklahoma City's 121-11 win over the Blazers. He had 21 points, 14 rebounds, and 11 assists, but it wasn't even his team's most impressive triple-double. Paul George posted an insane 47 points, 12 rebounds, and 10 assists. James Harden extended his streak of 30-point games as well. He's now at 30 in a row after dropping 31 in Houston's 120-104 victory against in-state rival Dallas. Harden's 30th point came on a three-pointer with less than a minute to go to give Houston a 17-point lead. So pretty impressed with that performance. It's 7:01. Time to get that perfect Valentine's Day gift at Sharif Jewelers. Spend $99 or more and receive a pearl bracelet at Sharif Jewelers. Those are your top stories. Hey, did you notice that all those scores I read had 120 points in them?
That is pretty crazy.
130-120, 121-11, and 121-04. To drive, Sports 1140 KHDK.
I'm not letting you go to work today.
Wait, what?
Everybody, listen up.
Welcome to The Drive.
Morning, morning, morning.
You're going to talk.
Get on the phone at 339-1140.
Pretty awesome, huh?
Jump in on our text line at 44-1140.
Everyone is talking about it. You must know that.
The Drive starts now.
Three for Madness coming up at 7:15, brought to you by Fire Wings. We'll have football and basketball questions for you. We'll get into the Clippers and Kings, playoff positioning, Charles Barkley being a Nostradamus at 7:35. Then we'll talk about Kyler Murray and other football notes, including the Lions wanting the Raiders to do Hard Knocks very, very badly. It's coming up at 8:05. Drive question of the day. Is it a disappointing season if the Kings miss the playoffs? You can answer that on the Drive Twitter at the Drive 1140. On the Drive Facebook page, or text us here at 44-1140, brought to you by Jiffy Lube. Also, don't forget to watch the video cast we're on right now, khdk.com. You can watch on your phone, just scroll down a little bit, or a tablet, desktop, laptop. It's all right there. Hello, how are you? Welcome in. And you'll have even more fun next week on the video cast. I'm not sure if it's just Damien or Damien and Jason, but they'll be back next week. I will be gone. It's been a long time since I've been gone, so I'll be gone all next week.
Really?
Yeah, you didn't know that?
No.
No, sorry. Yeah, I'll be gone next week. I'll be gone next week. Everybody bitch and moan. I will be, and then that's it. I'm done until like August. I wasn't planning on being gone a couple weeks ago. That was a curveball. This I've planned. Be gone next week. Why do you say what? Wow. Way to not want to work with Damien and Jason, Kyle. That's pretty mean.
Shade at Damien and Jason.
A lot of shade. I'm trying to use the word shade less.
Yeah, it stinks that I have to, you know, be professional.
Right. Can't just screw off, buddy. Justin Verlander's mad.
He's probably mad because he didn't call Sierra Pacific for this winter's best deal on a new furnace. Call Sierra, don't end up like Justin Verlander. Call Sierra Pacific now, 800-551-3040.
See, I thought you had something to say. That's why there was that long pause, but then you didn't say it. I was pausing.
Sorry. That's my fault. You were I was thinking about the joy of working with Damien and Jason.
There you go. You're being facetious. That's okay. Justin Verlander tweeted out yesterday, 100 or so free agents left unsigned. System is broken. They blame rebuilding, but that's BS. You tell me he couldn't sign Bryce Harper or Manny Machado for 10 years ago from there? Seems like a good place to start a rebuild to me. 26-36 is a great performance window, too. Also tweeting yesterday, David Sampson, who is a former team president with the Marlins, fired by Derek Jeter's ownership group a year ago, tweeted out, there's a problem that will not be fixed by players systematically tweeting about the broken system. The reality is that players and agents have to adjust to a new reality. Kristen Yelich is the reigning MVP, and he responded to that tweet saying, consistent with your anti-player rhetoric, but adjusting to this new reality isn't exactly the solution either. Very interested. I don't know who's right on this one. I completely understand both sides. I really do. Players want to get paid. But
it's
teams also go, you know, this whole fire everybody, start from scratch, build up your minor league system and rebuild thing, that also kind of works too.
Well, and I think it was 10 years, $300 million that Harper turned down from Washington.
10 years, what?
$300 million.
Yeah.
$30 million a year.
Something in there.
That he turned down from Washington and went, I can get more on the open market.
Yeah. Man.
And then it turns out that the teams that were bidding against Washington, I guess, weren't really willing to go much higher than that.
Nope.
So now you have a 26-year-old former MVP who hits home runs and gets on base 40% of the time, who thinks his value is more than teams are willing to pay.
And doesn't the market dictate? I mean, the market's there for a reason. I don't think there's a collusion situation.
No, what? It's really hard to go backwards contract-wise, though.
Sure it is.
And you have Giancarlo Stanton got 10 years, $300 million.
Sure he did.
And Albert Pujols got 10 years and 260 or whatever the heck
he
got, his insane contract. And so did Miguel Cabrera. And those teams are going, teams are looking at those contracts and going, wow, that didn't work out.
No. It's too much money invested in one guy. I mean, look at the Yankees. Would they rather have that money back and spend that on depth? I don't know.
But if you're, I mean,
I don't see how the system's broken. It sucks that there's 100 free agents out there. Sign for less.
I don't know enough about the CBA in baseball to.
Here's what I know. Here's what I'm with you.
This is two years in a row that you've had like good free agents on the market for a long time, and that's weird.
Here's the thing. Here's the CBA in baseball. This is what I know. When you sign a contract, you're going to get paid every penny of that contract, regardless of how you perform, regardless of whether or not you get injured. They're all guaranteed. It's not football. They're all guaranteed. You're paying that money out. When you say there are 100 free agents out there on the market right now, that is a fact. But what I would like to know is how many of those free agents could be signed if they took the deals they were offered. Now, I understand that is not pro labor.
Right.
But I think it's a little disingenuous, like these players are being frozen out of baseball. No, they're just not getting the offers they want. Okay. Well, then you are making a conscious choice to not be signed by a Major League Baseball team.
And
if Manny Machado and Bryce Harper want to hold out for $300 million and then bitch that they're not getting $300 million, we're sitting
but
here
that's
in mid-February.
That's what the market has said they're worth,
but
though. And teams are now trying to undercut that.
Hold on. That's what the market said Stanton was worth, and that's what the market almost said Pujols was worth. And the market also corrects itself. The market learns. The market makes its own corrections, whether we're talking baseball or whether we're talking about the U.S., whether we're talking about companies, the market will correct.
But it's not – I guess it's not – like I said, I don't know enough about the intricacies of all this, but if you're, I don't know. It just, the idea of teams going, you know what? Like, this player's worth this based on what other contracts have been, but we're just not going to pay that. Like, I don't know.
There may just not be a lot of teams that are like, you know what? We can throw 300 out. We're in a rebuilding process. We're not in a position to do that.
I think Bryce Harper should take a one-year deal with the Oakland A's.
You know, and Harper is, I believe, a Boris client?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course he is.
I don't know. I don't generally take the stance, Kyle, of, screw the players. You're getting played to play a game. Deal with it. I think people should get paid what the market dictates. But if you've got agents, I think you have a situation where you have agents in their ear, telling them what they're worth, and they're listening to those agents.
Well, yeah, they're looking at just the complete 100-plus year history of Major League Baseball.
Sure.
Going, hey, you should be worth this, and now baseball's trying to go,
And you know what? It may behoove a guy like Bryce Harper to sign, I know you were joking, but to sign like a one-year $25 million deal. Maybe he's caught the market at the wrong time, and why do you want to cost yourself money?
This is 2 years in a row, though.
But the
it's not even just Harper and Machado. It's guys that are on those low. It's the lower tier free agents.
Sure, absolutely.
That teams would rather just not spend the money.
JD Martinez didn't sign until February 20th of last year. Jake Arrieta.
He's an MVP candidate.
Arrieta didn't come to terms until the middle of March.
Come to terms is such a funny.
I know. Come to terms with the fact that he hadn't been signed. I don't know. I think the market dictates what the market dictates. And if they're not getting offered, they're very good players. Machado and Harper are very, very good players. Top of the game. They're not getting the offers.
I guess, so if you're, like, if you're a baseball player, though, don't you understand why players even under contract are looking at this and going, this is trash?
Players that are under contract?
Yeah, you have two of the game's brightest young stars hitting free agency, hitting the free agent market, and there's just no market for them? Like, what? That's ridiculous. If you're not going to pay these guys, who is going to get paid?
I don't know. It's interesting. But if this is the second year in a row, then that to me is the market correcting itself.
We're barreling towards either a strike or a lockout, and it seemed like that.
Well, you can do
for
that
for a long time.
You know who's going to win that one.
Right.
So you can do that all you want. You know who's winning that.
You know who's winning that? Kyle Madsen, who's going to sign a scab contract.
By the way, I say that.
Average slow pitch player.
I don't mean to throw that away. You want to go in there? You want to play for the Giants?
I'm in there.
In baseball, much more than basketball and football, the players have more power. So when I say, you know who's going to win that one, actually, that's kind of a falsehood. You really don't. The Lakers are being investigated again, this time for Magic Johnson's alleged chat with Ben Simmons, but there was no real chat. Elton Brand had said yesterday on a Philadelphia radio station that Rob Pelinka called me and said Ben Simmons wanted to talk to Hall of Famers after the season. Magic was on the list. He asked for authorization. I said no. Brand called Magic Johnson yesterday after that and apologized for insinuating in that interview that the Lakers had called unprompted, when in fact that somebody with the Sixers, prompted by one of Ben Simmons' brothers, had contacted Rob Pelinka first, which is what got Rob Pelinka to then call Elton Brand and ask for permission. This one, as much as I love hating on the Lakers, this one sounds like it's much ado about nothing. Find him for other things, not this.
Hey, we're giving away tickets to the Toyota Save Mart 350. Got a couple of tickets for you. The Daytona 500 officially kicks off NASCAR season, and Sonoma Raceway is celebrating by giving you free tickets to the Toyota Save Mart 350 this summer. Call for your chance to win a pair of tickets for Sunday, June 23rd. Call it 8:35. We'll do 8:35. Experience high-intensity racing, air show, live music, activities for all ages, plus special celebrations for Sonoma Raceway's 50th anniversary. Tickets and camping packages are now on sale at SonomaRaceway.com.
All right, 8:35 you said?
8:35 is the call time.
So that's for the streamers as well and the video watchers.
Yep.
Kyle promises to remember to unlock the phones.
They're already unlocked.
Okay, there we go. 8:35, three for Madness coming up next. Would you want your team to sign Kareem Hunt? We'll talk about Harden and Westbrook's streaks, and are they impressive to you? I mean, they're impressive, but how impressive are they? We'll do that next on the Drive Sports 1140 KHDK. Three for Madness.
Yeah, it is.
Brought to you by Fire Wings.
21.
21 different flavors to choose from. Firewings.com. Just wing it.
There are Deion Sanders flavors to choose from.
Okay. Didn't have time to get into it in the last segment, but I got to talk to you at some point about the dog agility contest that I saw over the weekend.
Yeah, let's, you know what? Let's sweep that.
I need a channel for that. It's a whole channel of dog agility. Watch
it's called YouTube.
Yeah. Question one.
Would you want your favorite team to sign Kareem?
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't because I wouldn't want to deal with it, you know? Wouldn't want to deal with the circus. But if, I don't know, football, I understand football fans. There are football fans out there that just want to win ball games.
Yep.
And if a guy can help them win ball games, and the guy can help them win ball games. And I'm not here to arbitrate the severity of what Kareem Hunt did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what the NFL is for. Throw him into the legal system. Have him serve whatever he's got to serve in the legal system. Have the NFL suspend him for however long they're going to suspend him. We can argue about the length and if it was long enough or too short or whatever it is. But have him serve his time, and then after that, play the guy. I do believe in most cases, not all in second chances. I think there are some things that are unforgivable. And in this case, I don't think that's an unforgivable thing that he did. That's my opinion. I don't think it was. I mean, he's never coming to a party at my house.
Sure.
But do I think the guy should never play in the NFL again? No. And if that means that I'm a bad guy, then I'm a bad guy.
I wouldn't want my favorite team to sign him because I wouldn't want to have to root for him. Like, that's just...
That's the thing.
I'm not going to go, you know, root hard against the Cleveland Browns.
Sure.
But I don't want to have to root for Kareem Hunt. I have a hard enough time rooting for Richard Sherman.
and that's just because we
right,
we
and that has nothing to do with
wrong.
Right. He's a
we
fine
like
human.
Richard Sherman.
Yeah.
Number two.
Eric Reid got a 3-year deal from the Panthers. Is that significant to you?
I mean, if I'm the NFL, to be honest with you, if you want to believe in conspiracy theories, I call the Panthers and I say, if you want to sign Eric Reid to a 3-year deal, we'll supplement it. We'll find a way to donate something to you. Because Eric Reid has grievances with the NFL, and Eric Reid might have stood to make a lot of money off of those grievances, not to mention the fact that whether he made any money or not, I can promise you that the NFL was not real big on having NFL executives on the stand testifying under oath and having to answer such questions as, have you ever been aware of a player beating somebody and done nothing about it? They don't want any part of that. So the Carolina Panthers and their new ownership, in effect, did the NFL a favor. At the same time, forget about all the peripheral. Eric Reid's a good player. He deserves a 3-year
really
contract.
Really good player.
That's what matters.
Right.
So,
yeah, it's significant for sure that he didn't just get signed for this half season and they went, oh, this is a circus. Screw this. And I think it's good that David Tepper and the Panthers are sending the message that you can have your thoughts about society while still being compensated to play football.
Now, if we could just get done testing Eric Reid every 5 seconds,
please,
that would be awesome, too.
That would be amazing.
Number three.
Are you impressed by James Harden and Russell Westbrook's respective consecutive game streaks? Harden, 30 games in a row with 30-plus points. Russell Westbrook, 10-plus games in a row with a triple-double.
Yeah, I'm impressed. I mean, it's very impressive.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding me?
Yep.
That many triple-doubles in a row? Scoring 30 points is a big deal, and you've done it God knows how many times? Go ahead.
Russell Westbrook, for me, like, he hasn't been shooting well this year. And he's finding ways to impact the game. All right, great.
Yeah.
For Harden, I was impressed right up until last night.
You didn't like the fact that he scored what he scored and then...
Yeah, you could be sitting at that point in the game.
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, again, was watching the game. As soon as...
Yeah, never mind. He couldn't be sitting by then.
As soon as he scored, it was still kind of a semi-tight game. I think it was 8, 9, 10 points. But as soon as he scored his 30th point, He immediately started smiling. The crowd stood up. He was waving the crowd on, like, make no mistake about it. And here's the thing. They're very impressive streaks.
Yes.
But Westbrook and Harden are both hyper-aware of their statistics.
Mm-hmm.
They absolutely know exactly what they have at all times.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I've been to a game in Houston. I haven't been to a game in Oklahoma City. But I'll just bet that there is a full stat layout somewhere on one of the screens.
Oh, yeah.
Where they know exactly where to look. And much like we give Wilt Chamberlain a little bit of crap for scoring 80 points a game against a bunch of truckers, mm-hmm. and guys like that, this is the type of environment offensively that allow guys like James Harden and Russell Westbrook to do this. There is no way they're doing this in 1985.
He had 2.5 points with 2 minutes and 33 seconds left.
He had what?
20 points.
With how long?
2 minutes and 33 seconds.
Yeah.
He hit a three to make it a 12-point game. He hit a three with 157 to make it a 15-point game, mm-hmm. to give himself 26 points. Typically, at that point, timeout, you take your starters out. 15 points with less than 2 minutes left.
Mm-hmm.
But no, Harden stays in the game, hits a couple of free throws. It's 27 and 28. And then with 53 seconds left and his team up by 14, shoots a three to give himself 31 points. And then checks out of the game.
The 23rd and 26th points came against Justin Jackson. We got a break, but let me ask you this. I want you to think real hard about this. You're usually fair with your answers. How many games in a row do we know?
30.
30 games in a row, he scored 30 or more. If there was a streak of 29 games in a row scoring 30 points, and it's the exact same situation, but that was Steph Curry, are you telling me you'd have an issue with Steph Curry staying in the game?
Yeah.
You would?
Yeah, are you kidding me?
He scored 30 points.
Have you seen how many times he's gotten injured on weird plays? Get him the hell out of the game.
He scored 30 points in 29 consecutive games.
Ugh. So?
So your worry would be about injury, not about rubbing.
Yeah,
there's a
championship to go win, dude.
Okay. We'll take a break.
That's no question for me.
We will take a break. When we come back, the Sacramento Kings are the 8th seed in the Western Conference playoffs. If the season ended today, we'll revisit our question of the day. We got to look ahead to these next 6. How many do the Kings need to win, in your opinion? We're back in a couple. Sports 1140 KHDK.
Hey, it's Kyle Madsen with your top stories on Sports 1140. The Sacramento Kings did not play last night, but they got a huge victory in Minnesota where the Timberwolves beat the Clippers 130-120. That moves the Sacramento Kings into the playoff picture. They are currently the number 8 seed by a half game in the West. So if the playoffs started today, the Kings would be in. Russell Westbrook had his 10th consecutive triple-double last night. That's an NBA record. Oklahoma City beat the Blazers 120-111. Paul George also had a triple-double in that game. 47 points, 12 rebounds, and 10 assists for him. James Harden extended his streak of 30-point games to 30 in a row. He dropped 31 in Houston's 120-104 win against in-state rival Dallas. He had 20 points with 2.5 minutes left and scored 11 in a row before checking himself out. With less than a minute left in a 17-point game. Super impressive work by James Harden. It's 7:32. Time to get that perfect Valentine's Day gift at Sharif Jewelers. Spend $99 or more and receive a pearl bracelet at Sharif Jewelers. Those are your top stories. Now back to the drive on Sports 1140 KHTK.
Professional, concise, and always on topic. Three things you won't think of with the drive on Sports 1140 KHTK.
Hurtful but accurate.
Man, speaking of shade.
Me not we.
Yeah, me not we. That's our theme, buddy. Sacramento Kings, if the season ended today, the 8th seed in the playoffs, Kyle.
Yeah, I've been saying that in my update all day.
Have you?
Yeah. Good listening skills.
That's pretty insane, man. It's February 12th.
If before the season, this is my favorite thing. If I asked you before the season, because you had them at 3-17 through their first 20.
Yes. I had them at 3-17, but can we please remember I had them at 27-9 in the second part of that.
Yes.
I said 3-17 to start out, and then what nobody ever remembers is I said, then they're going to go on a 27-9 run. I just got it mixed up.
No, you didn't.
Well, they didn't go on a 27-9 run is my point.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
I got the start mixed up, but I nailed the wins and losses.
Okay, but actually, if I said, okay, 3-17 is your start, what do you think their record will be on February 12th?
If you'd asked me this.
56 games in.
26 games left. I would have said they'd have somewhere between 17 and 21 wins.
I was going to say 15 and 41.
Yeah, something there. Well, I figured 26 games left at that rate. I said they'd win 20 to 25. And a lot of that would depend, too, on, remember, going through an entire season if they're sitting at 15 or 16 or 17, you know, and understanding what, you know, they've had a fairly healthy season. They're in the 8th seed. And, Kyle, I have a conundrum.
Ooh.
Yeah, I do. I have a conundrum here. I feel like I have a responsibility as a Kings fan, as a host on the flagship of the team.
Extended Kings postgame show.
Yes. Or a very early Kings pregame show for tomorrow. I feel like with great, with a tiny bit of power comes a great deal of responsibility. And I don't know where to go with this. Now, I've had fun all year with going again, being very pessimistic. You know I'm a pessimistic guy.
Right.
Comes to this team. But as of late, I've been very optimistic. The team's given me reason to. And I'm not just going to stick to something to stick to it. You know, I'm going to talk how I feel It's always going to be the truth with me, whether it's good or bad. I'm always
the
gonna...
truth about your feeling.
Exactly.
You don't know what's going to happen.
I have no idea.
Right.
But I'm always going to throw up what I think.
Right.
So here's where I'm at right now. This is a great day to be a Kings fan. You've got national media swooping in. You've got power rankings where they're as high, I've seen, as 12 or 13. They are the 8 seed in a slaughterhouse of a Western Conference. They are looking down on both Los Angeles teams, one of which is the LA Clippers, or excuse me, LA Lakers and LeBron James, also the Clippers. But looking down on, well, let me ask you this. Which do you think would, I say, Kyle, one of two things is going to happen this year. We're talking back in October now again, same scenario. The Sacramento Kings are going to be 30-26, 56 games into the season. Or 56 games into the season, the Sacramento Kings are going to have a better record than LeBron James and the Lakers. Which do you think, which would you have said is, I've said one of those is going to happen for sure. Which is it going to be?
So they're either 30-26 or they have a better record than the Lakers.
And I'm saying one of those is true. I'm telling you at least one of those is true in October. Which would you have picked as more likely?
The 30-26.
More likely than being ahead of LeBron and the Lakers. I agree. I agree with you. Both would have seemed completely mind-blowing at the time. It's not just that they're ahead of the Clippers and the Lakers, and they're two games ahead of the Lakers, and they're a game in the loss column ahead of the Clippers, but they are tied in the loss column. With the San Antonio Spurs. Spurs have played two more games. They have two more wins, so the Kings are a full game back. The Kings are also three games back in the loss column of the Portland Trailblazers, who currently hold the 4 seed, which hosts a first-round series. That's how crazy this end of the season is. And by the way, the Blazers are in a stretch where I believe they play, I think it is 9 of their next 12 or 10 of their next 13 on the road. Mm-hmm. The Spurs are a team a lot of people have looked at and said, forget about the Lakers and Clippers. You got to go after the Spurs. But here's what I look at. Here's what I'm looking at right now, Kyle. If you look at just pure percentage, winning percentage of the remaining teams, the Sacramento Kings have the 12th easiest schedule in the NBA. That's after playing a top 5 most difficult schedule most of the year. I believe they're at number 9 right now, ninth most difficult. But for the rest of the year, with 26 games left, the combined winning percentage of their opponents is 492. Now, as I said yesterday, this doesn't take into account road or away games, and the Kings have 4 more road games than they do home games. That's significant. The LA Clippers currently have the 5th easiest schedule remaining in the NBA. The Clippers have 24 games left, their opponents at a 474 win percentage. The Spurs have an easier schedule, barely, than the Kings at 485. The Lakers have the 9th toughest schedule remaining in the NBA. I don't think, and I've said this before, LeBron James and the Lakers are going to miss the playoffs. And I also look at the next 6 games, Kyle. And we talked about this at length yesterday. I'm having a real difficult time finding 2 wins. And right now I'm saying they're going to go 2-4, but my 2 wins are home against the Clippers and at Minnesota. Well, Minnesota just beat the Clippers yesterday in Minnesota. And the Clippers have owned the Kings all year long. And the Clippers
tough matchup for them, for sure.
It is a tough matchup.
But it's going to be a different looking Clippers team than the one
it will.
That has beat the Kings 3 times.
It will. But this is also the same different look Clippers team that went into Boston. Now, Boston's reeling a little bit. They got blown off the floor by Indiana.
Weren't they down 28 to Boston?
They were.
Okay.
They came back and won 123-112. They got blown off the floor in Indiana the day of the trade deadline, and then they just lost to Minnesota. And also, I think it's significant to know that the Clippers will hold on to their pick if it is a lottery pick this year. So they are, in effect, from an organizational standpoint, this is Jerry West making the call, and he does not care. They would basically be trading a lottery pick in this year's draft and a smaller shot at Zion Williamson, but still, for the opportunity to likely face and get swept by the Golden State Warriors in the first round. So I am torn between going all in and getting excited for this, which is what my persona has been on social media. I've been all in, getting excited. Kings are going to make the play. And I believe that.
Mm-hmm.
But then the other part of me, the hide to my Jekyll, if you will, looks at the schedule and goes, I know how this is going to turn out. We're going to be Denver from last year. I know how it's going to turn out. The Lakers are making it. LeBron James isn't making the playoffs, missing the playoffs. Greg Popovich isn't missing the playoffs. And that's if we stay past the Clippers. We're going to end up missing the playoffs by a game or two. We're going to end up with 41, 42, 43 wins. We'll be at or above 500, which is fantastic. We're going to miss the playoffs. And I don't know which way to set myself and by proxy the other people I talk to. I don't know which is the more truthful, ethical, and responsible way to go.
Because we don't know, man. Just let the season play out. And they're going to win some, they're going to lose some, and we'll see how the let the chips fall where they may, you know?
On one hand, they are four games above 500, and they are in the playoffs right now, Kyle. On the other hand, there is a very real chance. There is a very real chance that today and until tomorrow, somewhere around 5 or 6 when they tip off, there is a very real chance that this is the high point of the entire season.
Maybe.
There's a very real chance. There's a very real chance they go 1-5, 2-4 in the next six and don't get as close to the playoffs as they are right now. I don't know which way to go. I'm confused, I guess, is my point, and I'm wondering if other Kings fans can identify.
Are you excited
with
about their upcoming game?
Against Denver.
Yes.
Excited.
Are you
like
going
I'm looking
to watch? Are you going to watch?
I'll watch every minute.
Okay.
Of course I will. I'll watch every minute. I also think they're going to get slaughtered.
And are you going to check the scoreboard to see how the Lakers, Clippers, Spurs...
Every
Blazers?
Single second.
Okay, then. Just enjoy it, dude. Like, rock with it and stop trying to protect yourself from this failure that you deem to be inevitable. Like, I know that that's what you're doing. You're trying to, like, keep it here. But, dude, the team is good. They're exciting. Like, let your excitement level come up. You don't have to be like, hey, I'm buying my Kings playoff gear now.
Right.
But there is a very real possibility with 26 games to go that your favorite team that hasn't been to the playoffs since before I had a driver's license is going to go to the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Like, that's a very real thing. That's exciting as hell. And if they don't make it, okay, you're bummed out for a couple of weeks. But then you're looking ahead to free agency, and you're going, hey, man, this team's a couple of free agents away. This team's going to be picked by everybody to be in the playoffs next year.
There are two sets of Kings fans right now.
There's going to be, like, a small portion of you that's a little bit sad, and that's not worth not enjoying this ride that they're
on
right
now.
I'm
going to enjoy it.
Okay, then.
I'm trying to
think... bitching at me.
I'm trying to figure out the level I'm going to allow myself to enjoy it.
Just go. Just let it go. You don't have to go bet on them to win the championship, but they're playing with house money.
There are two sets of Kings fans listening right now. There is set one, which is shut up and just enjoy it. Stop turning this into a negative thing. Just have fun.
That's me. That's what I'm saying.
And there's the second set that quietly is nodding their head right now. This is the set that compares this to for 14, 15 straight years. We have gone on Tinder or Bumble or Grindr or whatever it is. I don't know what they are. And
nice, dude.
And we have dated. And every time we think we find somebody like, hey, Dad, I found this girl, Jennifer. She's great. She's cute.
Okay.
She's college educated. I think it might work. Oh my God, she's a mass murderer.
How many times have they been 30 and 26 in the last 12 years?
Right. Like, not. They haven't.
So you keep waiting for the bottom to fall out. If that's your philosophy, like, if that's really, like, your philosophy on all this, that the bottom's eventually going to fall out and you're just waiting for it, then stop watching.
Okay, but
don't let yourself get excited at all.
But what if I'm not waiting for the bottom to fall out? I'm just scared to open up completely.
Okay. So then that's what happens. Let's say you go, you know what? I'm all in. This is a playoff push. You don't have to say, hey, they're going to make the playoffs. You don't have to make a bold declaration, but you can just be like, hey, this is a team contending for the playoffs because they are. That's a fact. Let's say they lose six in a row.
Uh-huh.
And they finish with 39-40 wins. That's still a massive success.
Of course
it is. And
they're
still a favorite to contend for the playoffs next year.
Of course it is. I'm not even.
So you're,
I'm not
so,
saying
so
this would be a failure.
You're bracing yourself for a fall. It's like you're like scared to jump in the pool when you think you're going to jump in and sink, and really you're going to jump in and the water's going to be up to your waist. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, you're bracing yourself for this fall that ultimately isn't going to be that far. Because this team is good enough. Like I said, let's look at this next six. Let's say they go 1-5 and they just don't recover and they just kind of hover right around 500 and they finish with 40, 41 wins and a few games out. It's still massively successful.
Man, there's some people,
massively.
There's some people that are super angry at me right now.
Yeah.
Why are you angry at me? I'm just being honest with how I feel.
You're opening up.
I'm opening up.
You're not telling people. You're not telling people how to feel.
Not at all.
You're telling people how
just
you feel.
Just being vulnerable.
But I'm explaining to you that you're waiting for the bottom to fall out. And you think it's going to be this massive fall to your doom when really it's going to be a massive fall of a foot and a half where you land safely on your feet and then you're looking around and you're like, oh, there's still a playoff team here.
From the 916. This guy's really mad. Really mad at me.
Jiffy Lube text line, 44-11-40. Let Dave know how you feel. Or let us know at the Drive 1140 on Twitter
and on Facebook. Nobody wants to even acknowledge. Like the hypotheticals on the show are really childish. If you don't think they're going to compete tonight, then shut the F up, Dave.
What? I don't think they're going to compete
tonight.
They're
not playing.
Oh.
You honestly know zero about, this is the same guy, you know zero about basketball, Dave. You're just good on the radio. Your takes are always off, like Luka being better than Marvin Bagley.
Hey, you're the only person with that take, by the way.
From the 209, this is a great point. I do feel like Matt Damon right now a little bit in Good Will Hunting.
I totally get the reference.
When Robin Williams is saying it's not your fault, it's not your fault.
Mm-hmm.
It's not me not wanting to buy in. Of course, I want to buy in. There is nobody listening right now that wants me to fully buy in. That wants to buy in fully more
right.
than
you're,
me.
You're walking down the hallway towards success, but you can't help but look over your shoulder.
Yes.
And think that some demon is going to grab you and drag you back.
Right.
But that's what I'm saying is there's not a demon there. You might just be walking towards that playoff. If the playoffs are the light, you might just be walking towards that light a little slower than you think.
And there's really, as we talked about earlier, nothing that's going to make this a failure. There's no failure of a season here.
We have Captain Optimism right next door.
Yeah, we do.
In Matt George. And he was like, I'm thinking 30, 33 wins this year mm-hmm. will be a success. And that they're already at 30 with a month and a half to go.
Here's my guy from the 916. Kyle's an idiot. He forgot we're the Kings. We're going to slightly miss the playoffs and then win the lotto and send the number one pick away. That's my guy.
Ah, hey.
That's my guy.
Joke's on him. They already sent the number one pick away.
Yeah, to Philly. I know there are a lot of people that feel the same way, and I just want them to know that you're not alone. I love it. I am into it. I am enjoying it. I am excited.
Repress those negative.
It's not negative. Why is it negative? It's
because you're like, I'm just waiting for the bottom fall. And I understand that's always there in the back of your head.
It's not even that I'm being, why is it I'm being negative as opposed to I'm looking at the schedule and I'm going, you know what? There's a very real chance of this happening that happens to be
sure.
negative and I want to be emotionally prepared for it.
Okay. But I'm
there's
saying,
no drama
I'm
here.
Saying there's no reason to emotionally prepare for that because the wound that's going to inflict is going to be, it's going to be a flesh wound.
You're saying flinching from a punch doesn't make it hurt less?
Yes.
Disagree.
Except this isn't even a punch. It's a small shove.
I'm in. My man.
Are they here? Let's do this exercise. Are the Kings better than the Clippers?
Yeah.
Are they better than the Lakers?
I don't know. I think they are, as a team, better than the Lakers. There is no doubt about that.
Right.
But I also think LeBron James is the best player in the world.
Sure, same.
And I don't think that his supporting cast is that much worse than the supporting cast he had in Cleveland that they went to an NBA Finals with.
Okay. In a much different situation. I think the Kings are at least better than both LA teams.
From the 916, Dave is an idiot. Boston gets our pick if it's number one. Philly gets it if it's two or below.
I think that's wrong.
It is, but people like to have opinions.
I feel like that's definitely wrong.
I think he's right. It's just the opposite, which is exactly what I said, but good text. Why does it got to be Dave? Why does it got to be that I'm being a downer? I'm not trying to be
a
downer.
You're being a little bit of a downer.
I'm not trying to be a downer.
Understood. I'm not trying to be an idiot, but here we are.
I'm coming on and I'm talking it through. I'm coming on and I'm talking it out.
I'm telling you, there's no reason to look ahead and go, gosh, 0-6, no, do this. Because, like, ultimately, like, if that happens, it's just going to be like, dang it. And then they play out the string and they hang around but are never really quite in it. And then the season ends, you look forward to free agency and you go, man, hey, next year we're looking at maybe not only making the playoffs, but maybe hosting a playoff series.
The future is certainly bright no matter what. I'm only talking about this year. That's all. I'm just talking about the immediate.
Totally understand.
But there is a large section of the fan base, man, that gets triggered. They do not want even a thought like this. It's all in, shut up, we're going to win everything.
Totally, that's every fan base.
Don't be stupid.
Not exclusive to the Kings.
I have been called a girl 27 times on this text line.
That's not a negative.
I agree. I'm just saying. It is house money.
It's absolutely house money.
And you know what I am happy about is that no matter which way this year goes, if they don't make the playoffs, I'll be disappointed. And that's our drive question of the day, which is why we're talking about this, why we're having a little therapy session in between games. Our drive question of the day, would you consider it a disappointing season? Would you consider it a disappointing season if the Kings miss the playoffs? And I think this whole thing is very simple. I would be incredibly disappointed at this point if the Kings miss the playoffs, because I have, and fans have, I think, committed themselves more and more to this year, believing. But that doesn't mean that it would be a bad season or a disappointing season. I find it almost impossible that the Kings are going to have a disappointing season this year. Like you said, they're playing with house money.
You have $10,000.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
That's all.
That's it. Appreciate it.
You have $10,000 that you have to bet. Mm-hmm. Are the Kings making the playoffs next year?
I'm fully putting that on the Kings. And I'm not getting great odds either.
Same.
Of course they're going to make the playoffs. You would think. You would think.
You know what else you don't have to worry about?
Mm.
You don't have to worry about big-time contributors leaving in free agency. Obviously, Willie's a starter, and he's been good this year, and he might bounce. But Fox, Hield, Bogdan, Bagley, maybe Harrison Barnes. Harrison Barnes. Like, they're around. They're here, dude.
Dave is like the
guy
Kings waiting.
The Kings are here, man.
Dave is like the guy waiting for the meteor to hit Golden 1. No, Dave is like the guy who has personally witnessed a meteor hit the arena every single year for 14 years, and a meteor hasn't hit yet, and I'm simply asking, am I ready to believe that there will be no meteor that hits the arena this year? Oh, I am. Oh, I'm not? Then I'm a downer.
But that's what I'm saying, is there's no meteor. A meteor would have been De'Aaron Fox stinks, and Buddy Hield can't shoot, and Marvin Bagley can't play defense, and he can only use his left hand, and he can't find minutes on an NBA court, that would be a meteor, and the Kings have 10 wins. There's no meteor. It missed. And you're like, it might bounce.
It's spoken like a guy who's got a 73-win season in his back pocket is what that sounds like.
I also have
like.
A blown 3-1 lead in the finals.
In the finals! What are those, Kyle? What are the NBA finals, Kyle? I don't know.
You know what everybody can agree to be optimistic about?
What's that?
Sierra Pacific. And it's time to call Sierra Pacific for this winter's best deal on a new furnace. Call Sierra Pacific now, 800-551-3040. Hey, did a meteor hit close and start an Arctic apocalypse? You'll need a Sierra Pacific furnace.
Charles Barkley is an optimist when it comes to this team, and we'll play that for you. We'll figure out what out of the next six do you think the Kings are going to win? What do they need as we look ahead to the schedule? We've got Kyler Murray. We've got the Lions wanting the Raiders to do Hard Knocks. We got a lot of stuff to cover in the next segment, and we'll take your phone calls at 1-800-920-1140, 339-1140. You can also text us, please don't, at 44-1140 at the Jiffy Lube text line. Remember, 800-920-1140, that's your Fire Wings hotline. 21 different flavors to choose from. Firewings.com. Just wing it back in a couple. Sports 1140 KHDK.